Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Magnify Church. My name is Tate. It is a delight to be with you on this Sunday morning. Let's stand together as we come before the Lord in singing, and I will read for us from Psalm 103. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. Let's praise the Lord this morning with joy and gladness because he saves and gives us wonderful grace.
Conquered the grave.
There's nobody like our God who offers grace upon grace upon grace. And our one firm foundation is the grace and mercy of Jesus Christ, his blood that was shed upon the cross, the new life he calls us into, that we might be able to sing in every circumstance before him. Let us sing of this news together.
When my world is shaken, you are my firm foundation. You are my rock of ages. Jesus, you are. When my world is shaken, thank you.
pray together. Our Father in heaven, how holy and matchless are you. Your wonder and glory displayed in the heavens. Displayed as we look up and see the wonder of the stars. As we look out and see the mountaintops, the horizons. As we look out and see each person that you have made and formed. In your great power, you spoke and all things came to be. And oh Lord, we see your glory, but we see our brokenness, and we see the ways that we fall short of your glory, that we fall short of righteousness. God, indeed, we are sinners. Sinners that continue to turn away from you, the mighty and worthy God. So have mercy on us, O Lord, according to your great love and compassion. May the Lord Jesus Christ and his mercy be made new for us today, that we might be washed as white as snow, that we might be cleansed and purified, that we might behold him through the eyes of faith. And what a wonder it is, O Lord, that in your great love, you called us to be grafted into your family, that you are a wonderful and kind and merciful Father who longs for us to be home, for us to be with you. And it was only through Jesus Christ that we might do so. What a wonder. Thank you, O Lord. God, I pray for those here and in our church body who are hurt, who are in pain. I do ask that you would heal. I ask that you would draw near, that your tender mercies would be made known within the hearts of these people. God, I pray similarly for those who have recently lost loved ones, that you might comfort, that you might give hope, a kind of hope that doesn't just gloss over pain or put it into a closet, but lets us fully enter into the brokenness of the world, for we know that you have overcome it. And so, Lord, I ask in these things that you might give great faith, that you might allow us to uniquely lean into Jesus Christ as we bear our crosses, that we could know you and love you more. Lord, I pray for our global partners, Jeff and Joyelle and Hazard in Kenya. We praise you for the work that you are doing in Rift Valley Academy. I do ask that you would bless the ministry that raises up the children of missionaries and partners across the world. May these kids know you intimately as their Savior. May you bless the parents of these kids who are, most of them, in their own ministries and places that are not their homes, at least not where they came from. So Lord, may you have told us that from the ends of the earth, that all people from all tribes, tongues, and nations will be in the throne room. So I do ask that their ministries would be blessed, O Lord, that you might have people from across the world come to know you. And Lord, today I pray that there would be a greater sense of awe and reverence for you from your word, that we see the glories of Jesus who calls the death to life. So help us today, Lord, and we do ask that your kingdom would come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray all these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. You guys can take a seat.
Good morning, and thank you so much for joining us today in this room or online. My name is G, and I am one of the many volunteers in this place. We are so happy that you are with us today. So one of the values of this church is reach, and we do many things, but this is so exciting to me to tell you about it. Nice, love it. So reach, there's this organization called Cadence, and you can go and visit their website, and it's cadence.org, and we have global partners working within this organization. And their names are Tim and Rebecca Hawkins, and they're in Germany. And I want to tell you about them. So they're in Germany, And what they do is they have this van, and they fill the van with sleeping bags, blankets, and you have food in there and other things. And then they travel from Germany through Poland all the way to the Ukrainian border, where they deliver these goodies to the pastors that are ministering people out there. So they can distribute those goodies to the people in need. But that doesn't stop there. What they do is they fill the van back with people, with refugees that have been facing the conflict and they want to get out of it. And maybe they only have their clothes that they were able to grab when they left, small suitcase. Well, they take these people in, families, they travel through Poland back all the way to Germany where they can help them and provide relief at that time. So that is such a great ministry. And let me tell you, when you're giving to Magnify and when you partner with this church, you're also doing this job. You know, we are supporting other global partners like Josh and Sarah Whitman. They are in Italy with their family, and they're doing the same thing, supporting people that left Ukraine because of the conflict. But also we have the mills in Israel that they are taking care of the Jewish Ukrainian people that have been accommodated in there. So thank you so much for your faithful giving. We are making an impact across the globe. So now I want to ask you to prepare your hearts. We are going to sit under the Word of God, and we are going to learn. This is a great way to worship God also.
Good morning. If you have a Bible with you, please turn to John chapter 11. In just a moment, I'll begin reading at verse 1, and as a way of thanking but also reminding, I just appreciate whether you're here in person or you had to join us live stream today, that you've taken the time to set aside this day and this particular time as the people of God in this place to do this together. And if I had to give you a word that I would want you to tuck away when you think about going to church regularly, why do we do it? Well, we worship and we sit under the Word of God, but we do it together. And a good word to think of is formation. You and I are being formed, not just as individuals, though we all have individual lives and experiences, even in church, but we're being formed together as a people, as a unity that manifests Christ by the way we live together. So every week is part of that formation. So I appreciate and want to encourage you to keep doing it. It's very important, and thank you for doing it again today. John 11, 1. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent to him, saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, this illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you. And are you going there again? Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks in the night, he stumbles, because the light is not in him." After saying these things, he said to them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will recover." Now Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought that he meant taking rest in sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus has died. For your sake, I am glad that I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." So Thomas, called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." What's the most important question you've ever been asked? Think about that for a second. The most important question you've ever been asked. Maybe it was, "Will you marry me?" Maybe it was something else. Maybe, like me, when I tried to think to myself, this little project, I had a hard time coming up with what it would be. And maybe you're there. It is kind of a difficult question to ask. But by the end of today's lesson, we will all know the most important question that lays before us. And that's where our story's going to take us. And the story of Lazarus is, again, another one of those Bible stories that is very familiar. Whether you're a Christian, there are many people outside the church and outside of Christianity who will refer to Lazarus and as somebody or something coming back to life. There's something very compelling about this story that even if we don't ascribe to following Christ, we know elements of it and we're drawn to it. As we get into this story, though, too, I want you to think of the Gospel of John as we've gone through it. And if you remember way back near the start, the first miracle, what was the first miracle that John records for us that Jesus did? And it was at the wedding of Cana, where he changed water to wine. And except for the resurrection, this is the last miracle that John is going to record for us. And these two stories serve like bookends. One's a wedding, one's a funeral. And there's very powerful connection and symbolism that gives meaning not only to both stories, but provides a powerful meaning for everything that's gone on in between. And what we know is, if you remember, at the wedding of Cana, when the problem of a shortage of wine is brought to Jesus by his mother Mary, he says, "What does this have to do with me? My time has not yet come." But now here at the tomb of Lazarus, the time has come. Jesus will hang on a cross in about a week from this story. So to look at the story, let's understand its basic structure. There's four parts to it. There's Jesus and his disciples, then there's Jesus and Martha, then there's Jesus and Mary, and then there's Jesus and Lazarus. And it unfolds very simply like that. And I want us all, as we go through this, it's almost like John is writing it in four acts. If this were a movie, this would lay out really nice for us. So I want us to go through this as if we're going through a story and we're hearing it, but I want us to see it in our mind that we're going from scene to scene and to scene, and the scenes have different aspects to them, which I'll talk a little bit about. We know from what we've been told here and in other places, Mary and Martha and Lazarus are siblings. and they have a great deal of affection for Jesus, but also each other, and he for them. And as this story starts, news is being sent from Mary and Martha to Jesus. And as the news comes to Jesus, we're in that first scene, and he's off in Bethany. He's not far away geographically, but he's apart from them. And it starts like this. So the sisters sent to him, saying, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Now, I've highlighted this part because we're going to return to that phrase later on. So scene one, Jesus is with his disciples, and he's just a few miles off, but this message comes. And as the message gets there, we're given the distinct impression that Jesus doesn't know Lazarus's situation. Or if he did, he certainly has not acted as if he did. So when the message comes, it begins to put things into motion. And what we seem to be let in on here is that Jesus is so intimate with his Father that when this news comes, which surely not only does God know, but he's sovereign over it. The Father knows all this is happening, and he's directing it in a very mysterious way. But once Jesus gets it, it's like he knows instantly what God wants him to do and what he's going to do. And so in the Lord's Prayer, when we pray that, you know, God's will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. What does that mean? It means this. Jesus, God's will is instantly being received by Jesus, and he's going to do it. That's how it will happen in the new heaven and the new earth. So here, Jesus, he foreshadows what he's going to do. But then the story continues. Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Now, this reads odd at first. If Jesus loves them, I mean, if someone you loved sent word to you that one of their close relatives was dying and wanted you to come right away, what would you do, or what would you say is evidence that you care? You'd go right away, right? So it seems odd at first. It's telling us because he loved him, he hesitated. Not hesitated, he delayed. How is that love? Well, Jesus knows what he's going to do. He just said it. He said the Son is going to be glorified. And what he's telling us is he's done untold numbers of miracles. Some are recorded. A few are recorded for us in Scripture. He did many, many more. Would fill books upon books. But he's only going to do one more. And it's going to be unique amongst all his miracles. And he's going to do it for somebody he loves very much. And so he's chosen them. And he's reserved this special miracle, this unique miracle for his close friends. But as this is becoming aware to the disciples now, they have a concern. "Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you. And are you going there again?" So we've heard all these teachings over the last few weeks where Jesus teaches, And he keeps using this phrase, I am. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the good shepherd. And the I am, he's equating himself to the great I am. And so as he teaches this, there are people getting angrier and angrier at him. And some of the stories, people actually have already picked up rocks ready to stone him. But each time, he gets away. He somehow avoids the arrest. He avoids the stoning. And every time that happens, it tells us his time has not yet come. But now, his time has come. So he is moving differently. And I'm not sure how much affection or like, or even how acquainted they were with these three. They certainly knew them and had a meal in Martha and Mary's house and things like that. But they don't seem to be thinking of Lazarus at all. And fear seems to be driving them. And it could be a personal fear, but it could just be a fear for Jesus. Well, Jesus responds to them. And he says, are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks in the night, he stumbles, because the light is not in him. Well, what is he saying here? Well, we already know from a previous teaching that he is the light of the world. And at the time of the teaching where he says, I am the light of the world, but the light is only here for a time. And so we've got to work while the light is here. And one could read, if all you read is that, you might think, oh, Jesus is the light of the world, but now that he's died and resurrected and ascended to heaven, the light of the world is no longer here. But that's not true, because he tells us clearly in the Sermon on the Mount, you are the light of the world. So he came and he did his work as the light of the world. And now us, the church, we carry on with the Spirit in us. We are now the light of the world. But here he's talking about himself, and you just plug the reality that this is him in there, and he's basically saying, stick with me, guys. If you stick with me, you're on the right track. If you don't stick with me, you're going to stumble, because I'm not in you. Stay with me. Trust me. He has a mission. And hopefully by this time, they see that Jesus is determined to stay on the mission that his Father is giving him. Back in John, near the start, John 4, he had to go through Samaria. There's a woman there to meet. And he had to heal the man lame 38 years on the Sabbath. And he had to heal the man who was blind and do it on the Sabbath. It's all very purposeful. And God is sovereign, which means he's directing all of human history. And Jesus is following what the Father is telling him to do. And now he continues on. But you, followers of me, stick with me. I am the light of the world. So Jesus leads here. And Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus has died, and for your sake I am glad that I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him. So Thomas, called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go, that we may die with him. Well, obviously the part that jumps out is the end. The disciples are ready to die with him. As Jesus said, this is the plan. They have to choose right then and there. Are we going to go with them or not? And they decide to go with him, expecting to die, which is interesting because by the time they seem so devoted, but what's going to change when Jesus is arrested and executed that everybody abandons him? We'll get to that later. But right now, they're with him. They're with the light. And at this point, they're starting to move, and the drama is going to shift. And we're gonna pick up the next part of the drama. And we know from what Scripture tells us that Mary and Martha are there grieving their brother, and he's been dead 4 days by the time Jesus gets near. And there were many other Jews there with Martha and Mary, consoling them and grieving with them. But as they go to be there with them, somebody is going to come out to meet Jesus before he gets to the house, and it's Martha. So Jesus and Martha meet. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, but Mary remained seated in the house. All right, if you know Martha and Mary and stories from Luke, we'll get into more of that the next sermon I do on this, on chapter 11 here. But we know they've been with Jesus before, and there was an incident at Martha's house. She invited them all over for dinner, and while she's busy getting everything ready, Mary just sat there at his feet listening to his teaching in a very worshipful way. And Martha reached the point where she gets angry at Jesus and confronts him and accuses him of not caring. So it's interesting now, we have these same two ladies, and one, when word comes that Jesus is near, it's Martha who goes and Mary who stays. And with only that other story, I would have expected Mary to go, but if Martha's going, I'm worried that there might be some trouble coming. And the way John records this part, so first it's Jesus and his disciples and they're talking, but now John is just going to write and he's going to isolate these two. So clearly Jesus had his disciples with him, but when Martha gets to him, all the dialogue is individual. And again, if this is a movie, the director's got everybody out of the scene. They're there, but they're not in the conversation. And it's these two alone having a conversation. And if you're there with one other person having a conversation, where are you looking? You're looking right at the person. And they're looking right at you. And Martha's looking right at Jesus. And he's looking right at her. And what's Martha's state as she gets there? Martha's deeply grieved right now. She is deeply grieved. And it's in the midst of this deep grief that she comes out, and she's going to have a brief conversation with Jesus, the first part of which most of us have had with Jesus. Most of us have had some version of the conversation that Martha had with Jesus that day. And if you haven't had a version of this, you're going to have at some point in your life. So Martha speaks first. Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give to you. And it's this first line, if you had been here, Jesus, this tragedy would not have happened. Is it a rebuke? Knowing Martha's history? Somewhat? We don't know to what extent. But it's clear she felt the need that her first words were this. They're not, "Lord, I'm so glad you're here." No. If you would have been here, "Jesus, I've watched you. I've been one of your devoted disciples. I've seen you do thousands of miracles. I've seen you heal total strangers. I've seen you heal people who didn't even ask for it. And now us, your closest friends, at our time of deepest need. And we sent for you. And we got nothing." What's your version of that conversation? What's happened in your life where the thought comes to your mind, I know Jesus, I've seen people recover from this. I've seen people get out of these situations restored. I've seen that happen. I've seen parents who love you, whose kids go to the brink and they come back. Why not me? Why not now? Why no recovery here? But even now, I know whatever you ask from God, God will give to you. She seems to cling somewhat to a reality that he does have a special connection to God, but she seems mystified why it wasn't of any benefit to her and Mary and Lazarus. Well, Jesus tells her, "Martha, you know your brother will rise again." And she says, "I know that in the resurrection he will." And at this point, when he says, "I know that in the resurrection," the resurrection for her is this abstract event in the future. But like you and me, she wants her brother now. She wants that, but she wants him now too. And this abstract future she believes, but her loss is great. And now Jesus is going to give a statement, and then he will present what is for all of us the most important question we'll ever be asked. He said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die." Do you believe this? Martha, here in your deepest grief, here in this moment where I have not come through for you the way you had hoped. And look what he says. He's using another "I am" statement. But there's nobody there who's going to stone him at this point. The resurrection you believe in is an abstract future event. But the reality is, the resurrection is me. I am the resurrection. It is not just a future event where you come back to life. It is full life in me through faith. And whoever believes this, if they're dead, they'll live. If they're alive, they're never going to die. And this is a big, I want you to take, Martha, I want you to take your abstract understanding of resurrection, and I want you to allow the reality of me to fill you in this moment, in the midst of your grief, in the darkest time of your life. Can you cling to this? In the midst of something that's gone on, and it just seems to have no end, and it's taking you to the brink. Can you believe this? Do you, Martha? And the way John has isolated these two, it's like the camera, the director's put the camera right over Jesus' shoulder so you can see him gazing right into her face as this question's asked. And we stare at Martha long enough, and we stare at her so long that we begin to see ourselves. He's asking us the question. And so the statement and question for all of us is, do you believe this, that he's the resurrection and the life? Do you believe it? Not just abstractly for the future. Do you believe in the midst of your quarrel with your wife, with your husband, with your parents, with your kids, with your best friend, with your boss? Can you believe this in the midst of broken relationships? Can you believe this in the midst of anguish that comes with tragedy and sickness and loss? And again, John is isolating for a very good reason, and he strips everything away. And he wants us to strip everything away. He's looking us in the eye. He's looking you in the eye. And if we stand there and say, well, I want to believe in you, but there was this Christian person in my life who treated me poorly. They abused me. They hurt me. Or this church I went to was terribly divisive and they hurt me. Or I have these my best friends, they're not even believers. Why? Or there are these arguments and this, and I don't understand. And John says, strip that away. Look him in the eye. Because he's looking at you. Now, with all that gone, and just the person there, do you believe this? And Martha's response is this. She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world. Now, if you're a professor grading her answer, this is an A+, because she doesn't just say, yes, Lord. Look at the parts of it. I believe you are the Christ. This is a position. It's a title. You're the Savior. But you're not just the Savior. You're the Savior who is the Son of God. And even though you're the Son of God, you are God himself, you've come into this world to be fully human with us. I believe that whole thing. And this is what belief is. But she's doing it at a time where so much in her world is broken and sad. Well, Martha is now going to go. Jesus is going to send Martha to tell Mary. She tells Mary, the teacher is here calling for you. And now Mary goes quickly. And all the people with her follow because they think she's going to the tomb, but she doesn't. She goes to Jesus. And it's not going to be isolated in the same way, but the first, Mary's first words, she speaks first, are recorded. Now, when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Now, the previous story back in Luke of Martha and Mary, they were very different people. But here, in the midst of their grief and disappointment, they're the same person. You end up here. It happens. You've been there. Many of you are there now. But then here's how Jesus responds to her. And notice the scene is different now. We're made aware of everybody else around in this scene. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. And he said, "Where have you laid him?" And they said to him, "Lord, come and see." And Jesus wept. I've highlighted these. They're translated. The Greek words are very powerful. And essentially, Jesus is experiencing intense anger and intense grief. Have you ever been there? They're both intense. And the Greek word is used in a way that would describe a horse who is greatly distressed, and the snort that comes out of them in their distress is going to be the emotion that comes out of Jesus because of this intense grief and intense anger. Well, why is he angry? He's not angry at Martha or Mary or anybody. He's angry at Satan and death. He created everything, but most of all, he created me and you and Lazarus and Mary and Martha in his image, and he loves us because he's fully human, and he loves us in a very human-to-human way. And he's seen all kinds of death and destruction. And so this is not new to him. But now it's here. He knows the cross isn't far away. And now it comes to him in a way. He knows what's coming. But he's seen his friends, his closest group, go through the grief that comes from death. And he's angry. He's also grieving. And Jesus is not some distant Messiah who will fix this world for us. He enters our grief with us. So he doesn't just see the problem and fix it. He enters it with us and feels every bit of it. Except his grief is in a perfect person. And because of his perfection, he feels it more intense. Well, oddly enough, at this point, there's division. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man also have kept this man from dying?" Isn't that interesting? This is a very human story. Nobody made this up. Well, weddings and funerals, they bring out the best in us and they bring out the worst of us. You ever been at a funeral where some are grieving but others are like complaining, gossiping, whatever? I've just described 98.7% of funerals. Well, it's true here. The presence of death, even that becomes divisive. And now we come to the final scene. So now everybody here is going to go to the tomb. And so the scene changes again. Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. And so this intense emotion is in him, because something is behind that stone besides Lazarus. It's death. And Martha tells him, warns him, he's been in there 4 days. There's going to be a smell. And the 4 days, the Jews believe that when a person died, for 3 days, the spirit of the person hovered nearby for 3 days before going on permanently. And so Jesus comes very intentionally on the fourth day, when even the spirit, this is double death. She warns him about the smell. And Jesus replies, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" It said to her, but yet he didn't say that to her. He said that to the disciples before they left. And so now he's talking with Martha, but his response is really to all of us. Faith precedes evidence. Now, it doesn't mean we're without any evidence. We have the Word of God. But when somebody tells you, asks you, how do you know the Word of God is true? And the theological seminary response is, well, Scripture is self-authenticating. It's true because it says it's true. It's not very convincing to a lot of people. Oh, why didn't you say so? I'm self-authenticating too, right? No. But faith, we get to read all this, but there's a lot of us, maybe some in this room on live stream, you haven't come to Christ yet because you're waiting for a better argument. You have some big questions about evil and disaster in the world, or you're waiting for a better argument from about science or the age of the earth, there's just something that you need to see more. And even some of us as believers, there are times in my life where I just would like to see a little bit more. If you believe, you're going to see the glory of God, and it will blow away everything you and I imagine. What we would like, if we could get one wish from God in this world right now, it would be wonderful. But what he's going to show to us because we believe will blow that away. And it will come for life everlasting. If you're waiting for more of a sign, don't wait. Believe. You'll get more than you ever expected. At this point, they take away the stone. When he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" Just before he says it, he says, "Father," he prays to God, "Father, thank you that you've heard me." And I even says aloud, I'm saying this for everybody else's account so they know we're connected. But why the loud voice? That loud voice is interesting, because couldn't he have just said, "Lazarus"? Jesus whispered, "Lazarus, come out." He doesn't. He says it loud. And that's really fascinating, because there's going to be one more time when Jesus uses a loud voice in his life. It's going to be his last words from the cross. "It is finished." And it says he said it in a loud voice, which is incredible, because to even take a breath in the condition he was in on the cross would be extremely painful. So to even speak a word was even more painful. But then to muster the strength to yell, "It is finished," would have increased his pain 100-fold. But he seems to reserve this yell when evil is being addressed directly, when he's talking straight to death. "Lazarus, come out. Satan, you lose. I have power over death." And this symbol, this last miracle, is looking forward. You know what's coming in a week. So do I. And you lose. And I get the final word. And Jesus' final word in this section of the story: the man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips and his face wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Between services, I was talking to Tate, who led worship for us this morning, and he pointed out the fact that it doesn't say Lazarus came out. The man who died. Well, why the man who died? Because it's all of us. It's anyone who comes to him in faith. We come out. And then this last phrase, "Unbind him and let him go." The binding. What's binding you today? What sorrow? What grief? What death is clinging to you and binding you? Day of unbinding awaits all who believe. And then you're free. And he who the Son sets free is free indeed. Here's our question for the week. In the midst of your sin, brokenness, and grief, do you believe that Jesus is the resurrection and the life?
We're going to sing this last song, and I invite you to stay seated until I'll invite you to stand and internalize for yourselves. The Lord Jesus calls you out from the grave. Do you believe he is the resurrection and the life? We too can be given new life in Jesus Christ.
That you believe, safe and sound, stuck in the ground, too lost to be found. You just asleep, and it's time to leave. Come on, rise up, take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? You're we more than but it's a kind of love that washes sin away. Now the door is open wide, and the stone's been rolled aside. The old is gone, the light has come. So come on and rise up, take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? You're
Let's say this scripture together from Revelation as our closing prayer. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore. For the former things have passed away." Amen. Thank you. Have a blessed Sabbath. You are dismissed.